I like that people aren't. Mm-hmm. All right, and we're back here with part two, and we took a small break and we started talking about Star Wars, and we immediately had to jump back in. Okay, so we'll just assume it works then.
Yeah. Should be fine. I'm one with the Force. The Force
is
with me.
I'm one with the Force. The Force is with me. And the Force is with me.
So, speaking of which, so what's his name?
Chirrut.
Now, he was pretty cool. Now, was he Force sensitive, or is he just, you know, blind martial artist?
I think he's, like, he's not a squib in Harry Potter terms, but he's, like, the edge of squib.
Nice.
Where he's, like... He's force sensitive. This force is related to him, but he's nowhere close enough to be any possible Jedi. So there's like a character in EU stuff that was like a Jedi librarian that Luke trained in his eventual Jedi order. And she like would make, like if like a ball was thrown at her head and she wasn't looking, she'd like realize she should dodge. She had like slight spider sense, but she couldn't do any like lifting stuff. She couldn't like, you know where laser bolts are going to be.
She didn't have a lot of midichlorians.
Right,
yeah,
exactly.
I was just going to say.
Yeah. So I think he is a low midichlorian count force sensitive. That like he was a guard. They like maybe probably stole him from his family because he tested positive for Jedi-ness, but then wasn't able to cut it.
I'm sorry, your son's got Jedi.
Another reason why the Jedi had to fall.
Right. Yeah, no, yeah, they're not good people. I mean, we can get into how much Mace Windu should have been the bad guy in the prequels, but
say Empire one more time. Say
the.
That would have been amazing.
So I think like he grew up with them, and then like when you don't cut it, and like some of the books that deal with Obi-Wan and Qui-Gon kind of cover this a little bit. If you don't cut it, you get relegated to Jedi Guard. Mm. And I think that's what they were, both of them. And I think he still believed in it, and he was still all about it. And I'm so bad with names. Baz gave up. He lost hope and was like, I'm done with this. And that's kind of where they're...
Get a big old kid.
Well, no, he said at one time Baz was the most faithful of them all.
Right.
Yeah.
And so they were like, they're basically acolytes of the Jedi without... having enough to be Jedi.
But yeah, you could clearly see when there was a scene, he stopped, he listened, he felt the chain and pressure, you know, he was very, he had like a daredevil thing going on.
Yeah,
so I could totally see that, and that was fine, but is that the Force? Isn't it? I suppose he would say yes, but that's a gray area.
I think it's a line between, I think he trusts the Force, and the Force has been designated as a sentient entity sometimes, and so when he's just going for it, it's the Force kind of protecting him, and he believes in it so fully that the Force allows him to kind of get away with it, and he's a little bit Force sensitive, and he has a little bit of, like, Toph from Avatar, just blonde, Daredevil's a perfect example of, like, hypersensitivity to what's going on around him.
Well, there's a correlation between the Force in Star Wars and the Tao in Chinese mythology, and there is a section of the Tao which says when a man walks with the Tao, he can enter a battlefield and none of the arrows will touch him. So they say that when you are one with nature, when you have truly reached that point where you are at one with yourself and at one with the Force or the Tao, you could walk through a battlefield, no one will be able to harm you, you'll make it to the other side, and you can basically, you know, walk between the arrows, so to speak. So that was what I got out of Chirrut, you know, having that moment where he walked through the blasters.
You know, and that's what I was going to say before is, you know, we have the Death Troopers set up as these super badasses, only to have them then completely miss when Chirrut is walking through. Now,
I'm not sure that the Death Troopers came after he fell, because they were sent as Shore Troopers at first. There,
right when he's going to go to flip the switch.
I thought there were Shore Troopers at first, and then the Death Troopers came to reinforce them, and then he gunned them. What's his name? Baz gunned them down. I may be misremembering that.
Because Baz with the... If that's true, and I actually don't remember, so I can't attest either way, but storytelling-wise, that makes more sense, just from a perspective of what you're saying, but then also, Baz gets killed by them.
Mm-hmm.
He gets shot, and he's with the Force at that point. He's given in for the final time, and he kills them all. Literally, like, accidentally, because the Force is like... He, like, falls over, and the gun just accidentally fires at a guy.
Right.
But... Yeah, I feel like it would be...
Wouldn't that have been really amazing, though, if they would have set up the Death Troopers as being crack shots, and there was the one guy who was like, I got him. I can't believe it. And he keeps missing him. He's like, I don't know what's happening.
Firing
at him, you know, and him, and you realize that the Force works, you know, that he is being protected by the Force, because they left it pretty nebulous, honestly. Was he just a delusional...
Well, no, and Gareth Edwards said, he said he's fine with people reading in whatever they want to about those two characters, about their sexuality, about their ability to contact the Force, all of that. But he's like, I don't need to answer that for you. You answer that for yourself.
Right. He hit us over the head with all the other stuff, so he figured he'd lay back with Chirrut and his buddy.
There's so much hateration in this.
No, it's true. But it's true. You can't be a selective filmmaker. If you want to give people hints and not hit them over the head, give them hints and don't hit them over the head. But you can't have both.
It's hard to tell somebody what they can't do when you ain't getting the check.
I will say this. One of the most perfect movies ever made, and I think everyone here will agree, is Back to the Future. There is almost nothing you can pick out as a flaw in that movie but one moment. And it's terrible writing. And it's this. Hey, Chuck, it's your cousin, Marvin. Marvin Berry. Yeah, listen, that is the moment where they hit you over the head to get the joke. And that's the stuff that I think was bad in the movie.
I hated it. I was angry that it made a white guy win rock and roll. That was
awesome. Yeah, I was going to say, and then they gentrified black history.
Right. I'm not here for that.
Right. They say the heart of rock and roll was still beating.
And that was
written by a white man.
I will run you over my car.
So I mean, we do get these pretty badass characters. You know, we get a whole suite of new rebels that we can cosplay as. It's almost as if they're like, all right, that's the United Benetton.
We can play as live or dead versions of them.
Yeah, right. Exactly. You know, in between and stuff like that. So what did you guys think about finding out all of these characters that existed, you know, just before, you know, Star Wars, A New Hope?
I'll let everybody else go because I've got kind of a weird take.
Okay.
I do want to bring up, I guess, and this is, I guess, the moment to kind of talk about it, Jyn Erso. Because of the characters, she is blatantly the least developed. Yep. Like, yeah. And that was the complaint people gave, and I didn't really notice the first time through because I was at the premiere and just like super hyped. But when you know they brought it up, and they were a little bit more sensitive to that. And then when I watched the second time, I was like, oh, you're right. They literally, not one decision she makes, there's a reason
she
for.
She's the Jack Burton of the movie.
She just kind of goes where it needs to happen. And I don't think that's necessarily bad for having a female character that does that, because I think there's tons of movies where the main character is a guy and does the exact same thing. But I do think...
Jones. Take him out of the movie. Yeah.
Where just like, you know, and you could argue fate is it, and the nice thing about Star Wars, and we'll get to The Force Awakens maybe, and where a lot of those problems are based on fate, and not, you know, not a problem, but... I think they needed to do a better job with her. I think that's my big complaint about the movie.
I have a feeling, though, that was what they cut, was the interesting things about her.
I think
because,
both of them,
Because they, from what I heard, they softened her a lot from the original cut to the new cut, and she needed to be a person. Again, it's interesting to watch Cassian shoot someone at the beginning of the movie, and then he has that crisis of faith when he's going to kill Galen, and he's like, I couldn't do it.
Yeah,
I let him
right.
Run. So those are great character moments, you know, but when she is bland at the beginning, and I hate to say it because I love Rey. I think Rey is a great character. But like Jyn Erso... But Jyn Erso, like, was very... She was very bland to me, you know. I mean,
oh yeah,
I didn't find her a compelling character at all. I didn't know why she was so important. Okay, your dad is involved with, you know, and everything, but like, I wanted to know why she was so.
Well, I think what the Force Awakens had going for it, excluding people to my rights opinion, is that the main two characters of that movie, and maybe the third being Poe, had super charisma. They like, right. I love Rey, I love Finn. They're great characters. Like,
is that character or actor?
Both. I think even character. I think Finn's storyline in the movie is amazing. He goes from an actual coward. When was the last time we had a hero that started as a coward and then by the end of the movie gets to the point where he overcomes that and is willing to protect his friends?
He wasn't a coward until he got on screen, because in the previous material, again, he was like a superstar, a trooper, and blah, blah, blah. But then all of a sudden, oh, no, I've ever crushed
there. There are a ton of people that in training and cadet school are superstars and then they see their friend died and then become cowards. I think that's not a crazy thing to happen to a person. But... regardless, this movie had the exact opposite problem.
Right.
I think, like, what a lot of my complaints with Force Awakens are: the space battles weren't great, the second act would drag a lot, the kind of, those were the main problems, where this one had amazing space battles. The kind of the carry through at the very end was amazing, but the main two characters, like, weren't that interesting.
They were the sponges of the movie. And the supporting characters were better than they were.
Oh,
well,
yeah.
Again, when a robot steals is the best character in the movie, he was the best developed character in the movie, if you think about it.
Well, I think
he had a story.
Galen Erso, the main bad guy,
Krennic.
Krennic,
yeah.
and K2 are the three best developed characters.
Yeah, your villain is always going to be your defining... If your villain is weak, your movie's going to be weak. So you need a great villain. So you know, he was, sure. Yes, he had a great story arc.
What I really looked at it, and this is, you know, unfortunately something that I'm saddled with in my life, I'd look at it like, all right, so the only people of color are out on these weird worlds, and you've exiled them all from Coruscant, I guess? And
okay, well, they are so, space Nazis.
Yeah. I mean, no shade, but and I respect that ideologically, but for Coruscant to be an entire city planet, and if you tell me they cleared out all the people of color and nobody, no, all the stormtroopers, you know, who truthfully were once, what, Maori or something?
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Now they're, you know.
Well, they're not clones. Well, stormtroopers aren't clone troopers.
Yeah, even, oh, so when you went out and conscripted, you only conscripted white folks.
Yes.
So, oh, I mean.
Because they're space Nazis.
From a visual standpoint, I'm like, come on, fam. You're really working really hard to make this not.
I guess technically, stormtrooper-wise, the only stormtrooper we've actually seen with a helmet off in movies is African-American. Yeah. Or black. I mean, he's not American because he's in space.
I don't count him because he's not really an Imperial. Again, I don't really count the First Order as the Empire. I count them as cosplayers. You know,
but sure. I mean, regardless, we haven't seen a stormtrooper ever, so we have no idea. I mean, from
what
a,
color,
and it can completely be we conscript people of all variety of people, but
how,
the only people that we promote,
if you found out that they were all black,
right?
And then that was their thing, like let's make them.
That would actually
fun.
Make me. That would almost turn me off of Star Wars.
because that would be what space Nazis would do.
Right. Yeah. Well, I mean, it, like the whole thing with Grand Admiral Thrawn, who the people might not know who that is,
absolutely.
But one of the best villains in history, and ever. Only in the Star Wars EU, and now he's been brought back in Rebels.
He's in canon, baby.
He's canon still, which is amazing, and which means we have hope for so many other characters. But he is the only alien in the entire Admiral fleet that is at close to that level. So I honestly believe just, and even women have this problem. Like have you seen a women admiral officer in movies?
There's a moth, a lesbian moth that they put in the books, but yeah.
And Rogue One or Rebels
She's
now
a
has
moth
a woman
diver?
Woman general.
Don't be that.
Greg.
Don't be that.
Come on, you know that.
But I think that this is a society that is Nazis to its greatest degree, and their communities might have. Many people of different races. The rebels definitely do, and that was definitely what they were more trying to hammer in.
Yeah.
But and stormtroopers may be of different races, but the people that are promoted,
the people who run the show,
the people that are chosen to be promoted, that's and that happens here. Look at Congress. Look at the Senate. Like
and
we're not in the United States.
Even
not
critics
even,
suffered from that. Critics like I'm working my butt off here.
Right.
They're like still not good enough, sucker.
Yeah, you're low class. Your dad doesn't have 10 billion credits in his bank account, buddy.
Your cape game is strong, but your breathing is not.
Can we talk about capes for a minute?
Oh my God.
When are they going to come back into style?
I would wear a cape every day if I could.
Me too.
Well,
I'm wondering why they're not coming back.
Unfortunately, they created jackets, and jackets tend to keep people warmer.
Also, they get you killed.
A cape is a little
part.
Cooler. Though,
I mean, because I went to the Doctor Strange premiere, and they gave some of the people, you know, capes, and it's actually surprisingly warm. It's actually super.
It's
like
a poncho. Yeah.
This is cool. And you get to turn around dramatically.
Yeah,
so much.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. You can say things with a flourish with a cape. With a jacket. You're just an asshole.
Yeah. Maybe the like the lasting effect of these new Star Wars movies is they'll bring capes back.
Right.
Maybe,
Dracula without a cape? How menacing would he be?
Yeah, not
Batman
not so
without
much.
A cape.
It's just a guy with a widow's beak.
So
Batman's cape is in a slop
from flying.
So we did get a couple of Darth Vader like standing there, then turning really quickly, and the cape moving like.
Capes give you presence.
So let's talk about Darth Vader. You know, we have Darth Vader, like, you know, they went to the classic New Hope costume. He had red, like...
The red eyes.
I was blown away by the red eyes.
They actually talked about it because they said that he was a little scruffier in A New Hope, but they had shined up the armor a lot in Empire Strikes Back. And they said, we wanted to go somewhere between there for this because we understood where he was coming from that thing on Rebels.
Brand new suit.
But we also wanted him to, you know, have a little bit of gruffness to him. So they were very conscious of how shiny he was of the eye. They were very conscious of that going in.
Did anyone else distinctly notice, though, that it was not David Prowse? Like, the body movements seemed like they were...
It seemed like a thinner man.
Somewhat.
Yeah.
Yeah,
in the very
like tiny guy.
In the first scene, yes. For sure. I think it's...
Because the only thing
moving
by the head.
And like,
was
it
like,
felt
that,
like
that
his neck...
just looks heavy.
The connector of his neck and his chest wasn't as like blended as it used to be.
Yeah, he He also didn't have that fucking bodybuilder chest like David. He looked like a little guy in the suit.
If you've been to Disney World, they have this whole show with Vader coming out to help train Jedi younglings or something, mm-hmm. or whatever. And a lot of them are, I mean, they're tall enough, but the build is difficult. Yeah. The build is difficult to pull off. So this looked like a guy that had done some of that and came out. I mean, I don't know where they
it's actually got this.
I think he's an MMA fighter. I'm looking it up to confirm.
Please do.
But we should keep talking like
that. There was a strange... The weird thing when you watch the first three Star Wars films and you know that David Prowse is a bodybuilder, he does bodybuilder flourishes. Mm. That like when they're like, oh, let's look at his pecs. And, you know, they do the little flexing and stuff. He would do that. And you could tell if he was flexing in the costume and doing those things. And I think anybody else who's ever played him never quite nails that perfectly. So you don't get that, like, oomph of the original Darth Vader. But it was just weird. It seemed like it was a little kid in that suit walking around.
Yeah.
But, again, I'm going to get hate mail for that, even though it's true.
No, I believed, I thought he was a thinner human.
It's like, get a fucking bodybuilder to play the character.
It was played by Spencer Wilding.
And who is that?
He's a character actor. Okay. So he, like, plays characters. They don't have anything else.
Yeah, he's just a guy.
All actors play characters.
He's just a guy.
Yeah, you know, he's just a guy.
He was the double for Benicio del Toro in The Wolf.
Okay, so Benicio del Toro weighs 80 pounds. Yeah. So that's answers my question.
Yeah, but yeah, I mean, I I've always loved Vader from the very beginning as a kid, you know, and to now see him on stage, right, as the original Vader was a great thrill, you know,
to see him work.
Yes, I do agree with what you said earlier, Vito, that, you know, when we're introduced to Vader, he gives us, like, you know, a two-paragraph monologue, and yes, every time he speaks, I now know more of him, so he becomes less cool. You know?
Yeah, but then in the next scene, he does the best thing he's ever done on camera.
Like, I felt like that was them, though, apologizing for him being kind of not as mobile in the other movies. Like, they were like, we need to show him being a badass.
Yeah, because they switched his lightsaber style from a more athletic thing to a more direct, as he says, tank version, where he just plows through people.
Well, and that's what he does to... I mean, part of it is because we haven't seen Darth Vader as Darth Vader fight in movie... excluding Ahsoka Tano fights and Rebels. We haven't seen him fight a Jedi that was capable. Mm-hmm. Right. We've seen him fight Obi-Wan, which was literally them, like, testing it out, and Obi-Wan realizing, if I kill myself, I'll let Luke go. And then we see him toy with Luke in two movies.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
even in Jedi, where Luke is trained, he's toying with him.
Yeah.
And it's Luke trying, and Luke's not fighting back. He's trying to convince his dad not to kill him.
He could have finished him with a lot of
that. And I will say, as someone, I've studied the samurai sword for a little bit of time. He does use a circular. He's toying with, like, a master can do small wrist flourishes, you know, and just keep you going in circles. Mm. And he does do that in the second, third movies. He's basically playing with Luke.
Right. And nothing in this movie was ever a danger to him. Yeah. When he walked into that room, it was, you're all going to die. This is going to be the most horrifying thing
that
ever
was,
shown.
That was an amazing moment. Yeah. And as I said before the show, too, I love that shot of the rebel guy. And you can hear the actor inside go, holy fucking shit! Like, I mean, it was so terrifying watching him go at them that I want to see more. I want to see a solo Darth Vader movie, and I want them to really make him a badass.
You know where you might see, what they might get sourced from? In the new Marvel comic, they did a story called The Show to Run War, where Darth Vader... He threw ships at people.
It's called, like, Vader crashed and then just...
They sent an entire rebel division after him. He's like, all I see is a bunch of dead people. Y'all need to either get out the way or get ready to die. And he finishes everybody.
That would be amazing.
And I do recommend, the Darth Vader standalone Marvel comic.
I read the first six. Yeah, so pretty good.
It gets better.
I think the best moment I've ever read in comic book history, and obviously I'm more emotionally attached to Star Wars than other things, is the moment where Darth Vader finds out in that comic book Luke's last name.
Mm-hmm.
The Boba Fett shows up, he's alone, I'm getting shivers just describing this, looking out at his Imperial window, And he's like, what was the pilot's name? Because it was after it's Skywalker. And then just the window shatters, and you're just like, yes! Wow. It's like, I highly recommend the... and many of the comics are really good. I also recommend the Star Wars one. It could
also be misconstrued as very comic.
But no, Skywalker.
No, no, it's well played.
Did you see the moment
after? Wow, did you say Skywalker?
Vader had been doing all these machinations trying to get to Luke and blah, blah, because he had a plan. He started to develop a plan. And at one point, he's just standing there. He's the only person on the bridge of a Star Destroyer, and he just says... And I'm like, oh, crap.
At this point, he's already looking for this kid to kind of make him into an apprentice kind of situation, because he's like, oh, great, someone that is angry enough to kill all the people on the Death Star. I can train him to kind of kill the Emperor to replace him. And then he finds out it's his son. And it's like, that's why wasn't the prequel this good?
Because all those people had to die.
That's true. Why has he never been able to sense that his children survived?
Ah, that's an easy answer. Sith don't sense well. Sith use the Force for attack and not for informational
purposes. They put the Force out of them versus Jedi, who spend much, much, much more of their time trying to take Force into them.
I don't even need to be here.
Sorry.
Well, duh, right? Also, I mean, obviously.
Also, there's I mean, this is EU stuff, so once again, who knows what's canon. Both Yoda and Obi-Wan picked the planets they were on, and obviously Obi-Wan had other reasons to pick the planet. To hide their Force presence because dark Jedis had died there previously. Specifically Yoda. Obi-Wan, part of the plan, eventually just became Darth Vader hates this place. He's never going to come back. But with Yoda, it was much more about that Darth Sith cave. It's all about that cave. He went there because this cave exists, and this cave is going to mask my presence from the Emperor if he's looking for me. Okay. Because it's like they cancel each other out.
Notice that Vader sent down an attachment. He wasn't going down there. He wouldn't get in the sand in that armor. He was not going down the
tunnel. In his defense, it's coarse, rough, and gets everywhere.
This is true. Yeah.
Not like you, soft and beautiful.
Oh, that's so
are
awful.
You an angel?
Hey, he got that booty. You didn't.
This is true. No, this is true. He managed to find the one woman okay with a homicidal maniac.
No, yeah. Their relationship. So
she's a lovely thing.
We were talking about this in the middle of the cast. 2 years ago, I took time to re-edit the prequels into new movies, and there's still three of them, and I did that using the Tratovsky movies cartoon show, and it works, and I'll share it with anyone who wants to see it.
I do.
But I've learned specifically, because I've gone through every scene to edit them, what's wrong with that movie, and specifically that relationship. He woos her with rape staring.
Yeah.
Wait, that doesn't work?
No. Literally every scene up until them banging is... Hello. I'm going to stare at you, like daggers at you for 10 minutes, and then you're going to ask me to stop. And I'm going to say no, and then we're going to move on.
Two things. First of all, I unfortunately know actually real relationships and marriages that have happened that way with people that
I'm not saying it's not possible. It
works pretty well for John Wayne Gacy, Jeffrey Dahmer, and all of the other serial killers that we know.
And second,
Ted Bundy was great with the rape stare.
She didn't meet a lot of guys that were eligible. She just didn't, you know.
She was a queen in the Senate.
Right.
Exactly.
She meets a lot of people.
But most of them are old
bad boys.
Yeah, and there's the bad boy thing. So, yeah, right. I mean, there are elements to it. It's like, yeah, it's stupid, but, you know, people are stupid.
That is true. And what is she going to do? Hook up with Jar Jar? Like,
literally, if you cut, like, a line of every scene, the relationship makes sense.
So I've actually seen his version, and I was surprised how much I cared, right? I was watching, and he mixes the cartoon and the movies and stuff that was cut out of other films. You know, you've got the deleted scenes and stuff.
Some of it would finally get the big Darklighter stuff that we all wanted to see.
Although that's from A New Hope.
I thought that Cassian was going to be Biggs Darklighter when I saw the picture of him originally, and it wasn't.
Yeah. The one thing, cool.
Who also had a cape.
Yes.
He did.
There's a thing I was going to say.
You're cut.
You're talking about your...
Oh, my cup. Yeah. Sorry. I thought you were saying my mic was going. I was like, we should turn it back on.
You're right. Yeah, no, you know too much.
My bad. I'm sorry, guys.
You're very surprised.
Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah, so you know, explain to us what you did. Like, one of the things you told me was for the relationship between Padme and Anakin, you basically cut the scenes early.
Yeah,
right?
Every single scene, if you cut the last five, like, maybe it's 5 seconds, maybe it's 10 seconds, maybe it's a minute, you cut out a lot of the problems with their relationship. Mm-hmm. And if you cut out... So they sleep together in the middle of the movie from, like, and it makes basically all the romantic tension go away. If you cut that scene out, and then the first time they say I love you and they have any full romantic moment is in the scene in the amphitheater when they're when they're about to die, way better. So much better. basically what I did is I took pretty much all of episode one out. I left the Darth Maul scene as just a prequel moment to show when Obi-Wan Kenobi's master dies. And because these movies should be about Obi-Wan Kenobi. I mean, if anyone's seen the Red Letter Media review, it's a great point that there's no main character in these movies.
Yeah.
And Obi-Wan Kenobi should have been that main character. So, to the extent that, episode one would be much better if Qui-Gon Jinn isn't the one that went on the planet and the Tatooine and Obi-Wan did it and made all those mistakes as the young person who doesn't know what they're doing. But okay, we digress. Cut all that stuff out anyways. And the first movie is basically Obi-Wan Kenobi being a space cop. Because that's what the best part of episode two is. And then what I kind of did was I took a lot of the scenes where aliens talk or robots talk, and I just put subtitles and alien gibberish in front of it, which makes, I've seen cuts with Jar Jar that's what they've done, and that makes Jar Jar way better, because he's not talking, you just have subtext. So you, all of the fish people.
The Gungans.
No. The other racist fish people. the Trade Federation.
Nimoy.
Trade Federation. All of that dialogue I used to kind of change the story to make it a little bit make more sense. So then it goes through that and it ends. You cut out the Yoda fight. You keep the Force fight between Yoda and Count Dooku, where they're like, we're space wizards. I'm an old space wizard. I'm going to shoot lightning at you. This isn't working. I'm going to throw a giant thing on your friends and escape. That's it. And then you end at the Geonosis fight. The second movie is all the Chertovsky cartoon. So, and people haven't seen this, even if you don't watch what I'm talking about, because it's like you'd have to find me somehow. that cartoon is maybe one of the best things in Star Wars fiction. It's gorgeous. The animation is amazing. It's the same guy who did Samurai Jack and Powerpuff Girls and Dexter and then the Vampire Hotel movies. but one of the best things I've ever seen, and it's a direct prequel to episode three. And so I have it lead it there, and then I have it end after Count Dooku dies. The thing that this leads to is you get Grievous in the second movie, and he's the villain of the third movie, and you have Count Dooku as the villain of the first movie who dies in the second movie. The problem with the first movies is every movie has this throwaway villain that doesn't matter, because it's supposed to be the Emperor the whole time, but you get, Grievous is supposed to be this badass character you care about, and you don't at all.
Right.
And so it kind of builds into you caring about these characters more, and I guess it works. People like it.
Absolutely.
I can't wait to see him.
That's ruin my whole week.
I was surprised. Have you heard of that cut that Topher Grace supposedly did a couple of times? Yes, where it's all space assassins. And he basically cut all of the three films into one film, and supposedly it was pretty brilliant stuff, but he was like, I'm never going to show it again. He showed it one time. He invited critics to it.
So someone wrote down the notes, and you can get,
Oh, interesting.
There may be
possibilities
to get you that version.
Oh, okay. Because I would like to see that as well.
It's cool. There's some editing issues just from where they transition. It's a little weird. I felt they needed and this is where I got the idea for the Tchaikovsky cartoon, is I think they needed this year on the front, kind of 1920s, just montage of what's going on to kind of segue between what's happening in episode two and episode three in that movie, because it's a stark transition where their hair is completely different. but it works. It's fine. I definitely would recommend that if you could find a version of it.
And actually, after watching Rogue One, I was just thinking about it. I was like, oh man, I wish you could now then cut another movie so that we can get the backstory of Ghost Dog. What's his name in the movie?
Saw Gerrera.
Yeah. You know, so just leading up all to that.
He was really wasted in
that
movie.
But we're going to see more of his story in Rebels this season.
Yeah. Damn it. I don't want to have to watch 900 things. I want it to be in the movie that I'm watching. So, you know what I mean? You should. Here's one thing.
So again, it's your expectation that you...
No. But here's something. No, because again, as a writer, do you feel that someone should have to read 900 other issues of a comic book that you're going to write just to get the comic you're reading?
But do you think you have to for this movie?
But I don't need to
know more about the character. I think that saying, if you'd like to know more about this character, go out and watch six seasons of a show. Why? But it should be in the... No, it should be in the movie, though. That's the thing. Everything you need to know about the characters in Jaws is in there. Do you need to fucking watch something else?
Jaws 2.
And read six books to get the backstory to make Brody a great character?
Here's the fallacy you're pointing out. Everything that you need to know about Saw Gerrera, that he was a friend to Galen, that he saved their daughter,
he
did... hold on. Everything that you need to know about his character, that there's things that you want to know, and those things.
But again, I would argue the things that I was told about Saw Gerrera versus shown as a character. I was told he was all of that, but all I got was three scenes of him being dramatic.
That was pretty good. But he did torture. He did torture a guy to the point where his brain was completely wiped.
No. He wasn't. He didn't do it.
Yeah, but he, like, if you notice his character before torture, and he's like a jokey, like he's like making quips, and then you notice his character after the torture, and he's just like not. He's not much more depressed. He's not the same guy.
Yeah.
Which and this is all the reshoots' fault. Like I think that's where, like, that's, I think his character, I think his character but was way
is,
worse.
This is the thing.
In a good way.
In the trailers where Jyn Erso's a rebel and she did, and the movie, she's just there.
She's like, there for the ride. She's like to, brought to point A to B.
You're supposed to get that out of the movie. I shouldn't have to read the prequel books to know that she's that person.
Well, so it's, I guess, a movie. My point that
if people don't want to read the books, they should get it out of the movie. It should be in the movie. That's my point.
But many people, the problem, didn't get the problem.
But again, when you watch the Avengers, my sister never knew shit about Deadpool. When she saw Deadpool, she loved it. If I told her, well, you have to read 800 issues of these comics.
But you don't
also
have to read that.
Also, but what I'm saying is, if I told her you have to read these comics,
but
you
if
also
she was
have
interested in Colossus,
to get those characters.
If she was interested in Colossus, she would.
I understand that, but what I'm saying is if the main character, you have to read other things to get what that main character is about, the filmmaker's not doing it
well,
the way they're
in,
supposed to.
In reference to Jyn, I agree, but your question wasn't about Jyn, it was about Saul.
It's about most of the characters in the movie, because they tell us about these characters, but I never got most of that other than Cassian shooting his buddy. I didn't get that these characters were those characters. It's the same thing in Suicide Squad. They say throughout the whole movie, it's because we're the bad guys, wink, wink. But in the movie, they don't really do bad shit. They're not doing bad things.
But there's a fine line between showing you everything, and which is bad too.
Okay.
Like Star Wars explains to you on the, not Star Wars, the prequels or Batman vs Superman explains everything to you as you're watching it. It's like, here, this is a character
and
believes this.
Also, yeah, that's
like
that's,
there's a fine balance.
Storytelling. But okay, watch Casablanca, and everything that Rick, everything that Humphrey Bogart
hold
brings
up,
to
up,
that
hold
character.
Up, hold
hang
up.
On, hang on. It's one movie. He that character, everything he needs to say is in the script. And it isn't told to you. He acts it out, and you know what kind of a character he is, and he goes through an arc throughout that movie. You don't need all of the other ancillary stuff to get what kind of character he is. What I'm saying is, if you make great characters, you don't. Why should you have to read all that other stuff?
I recognize and acknowledge your point with Casablanca, which is truly a literary script, which, I mean, the script on its own is a literary quality and can work. Star Wars movies were intended to always be kind of crap. George knew he was not the best writer.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
They were always intended
it's
to be popcorn.
To
so
yes.
You asking for these high literary standards is like asking for, you know, Eminem to write Shakespeare.
You could still argue.
Well.
You could still argue. Again,
come on, spaghetti.
What do we know about Luke Skywalker in the first movie?
That he's an idiot.
But in all of his actions, there's a yearning and there's a longing. That moment where he stares off into the twin suns and the music wells. It shows you everything you need to know about that character. There isn't somebody who's like, well, you know, Luke, he's a bored kid and he needs adventure. And he, like, there's a difference between
actually,
telling
I
you what the character
is
and showing you what
yeah,
the character
Baru
is.
Yeah, Baru said that. Baru said he's too much
that,
like
yeah,
his father.
That line was
like, he's not a farmer.
All his friends have taken off.
Yeah.
You know, he's getting
yes,
restless.
But that's still better character building than what we got in
real life. Yeah, with Jyn Erso, I give you, but I don't think. I think the statement that you need to experience this extended universe to appreciate this movie isn't correct. Because I bet, I think it's the opposite for you in specific, because you've experienced
so much of this extended universe.
I'm
a fan of character-based, you know, stuff. Seven Samurai, like, I don't need to know, everything you need to know about those characters is in the movie.
If you're a fan of character-based stuff, why are you even watching Star Wars?
Well, because
I also like
what
crap.
What are you even doing?
My point is that if this stuff didn't exist, if there wasn't a Rogue show, if there wasn't Star Wars sequels or whatever, I don't think you need it for these characters. I think Jyn Erso is underdeveloped. I'll admit that all day long, and I think that's a problem. But I think most of the characters, like, I don't think for Donnie Yen's character or Kage, they were pretty underdeveloped too. Yeah, but in the sense that this is a war movie, like, in Saving Private Ryan, I think they had as much development than many of the characters
there's
on that.
There's a gang of undeveloped characters,
about,
man. That's amazing.
Yes.
Yeah, and, like, comparing it to Casablanca is unfair, because it's the, what, like, this is not the top 10 movies of all time. Casablanca is.
But there was that really amazing moment when they were in the prison, and Chirrut said, some people get put into a prison, and you carry yours around. Mm. And there was this really great moment where, I forget the actor's name at the moment, But where he looked back at him like he was like, "You just nailed me perfectly." And he stares at him for a second, and then he looks forward. And I was like, "They're gonna reveal something about this guy, why he's carrying this prison around." And then nothing happens. Like there was no.
Well, then what happens is he then recognizes. Oh wait, is that the pilot?
Oh right, and I have then, to get back
then,
to work.
Right, and then like, oh, plot point. There we go.
Wait, make excuses.
Actually, wait, which character are you? I have to figure it out.
Cash it.
Okay.
So they have that moment where he says most people, you know, get put into a prison, but some carry them around, and you're the type who carries around his own prison. And Cashin has that moment where he looks at him and he realizes it's right.
I get that. When he says, "When I was six, I lost everything. And I'm in this for my child." Like, Cashin, you're asking for this not to explain everything while also explaining more. And I think this is really difficult. And I think in every movie, period, each character has this problem of being one way or the other.
Yeah, you're really asking for a sports car from a minivan. I mean, this is not Casablanca. Asking for anything from Casablanca.
But then why try to make a war movie that's from something that's supposed to be pulpy? They were obviously reaching for.
They were
something
making more. A war movie from Star Wars. That's not a long. That's not even walking outside the house. That's walking into the living room.
But I mean, Joe, don't compare it to Casablanca. Compare it to Save It Private Ryan, or compare it to Jarhead, where
there's
like
a lot I had wrong with Saving Private Ryan too in terms of character.
But. Oh, sure, but and I'm not saying these are perfect movies, but I think they are remembered very fondly as great movies of cinema, right. And yeah, they have genre. Similar character. Like the point is, you have to care enough about these characters so that when they die, spoiler, they all die. yeah, I guess if you don't, yeah, the main characters. That you care that they die, and you're sad about it. And some of them I didn't. I wasn't as sad.
I wasn't sad
and,
about
and,
any
and I won't say this movie is perfect, and I think that's the flaw with the first half, is their character development wasn't strong. But I think on many of the characters, they did a pretty good job. I think some of them, they did worse of a job, and I think you have to balance that. But that's kind of the problem with an ensemble film. Like, even Ocean's 11, which I love as a movie, most of the movies are like, here's your job, here's what you gotta do, here's three bit things I need to know about you, and we're done. And this kind of maybe on some characters did a little too much over that and a little less on others. Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah, I was hoping when Cashin's like, all right, yeah, I'm with you. All these guys are with you. I was like, I wish that's where the movie began, right? Where we find out who all of these people are, and then they go off to die.
But Juan, that's what the books are for.
Right. Well, but that's what I would have loved to have
actually,
seen.
I don't care about most of those people because I knew they were fodder at that point.
Well, sure. So.
But look, did you need to know what the best cameo in this movie, but do you need to know more about Gold Leader from the original Star Wars movie? Because I don't think you did in this one either. And like that's what all those guys were. I don't need to know more about Dak in Empire Strikes Back. I get that him and Luke are pilot friends, and then he died. I got that all of those side characters were Cassians, and he tells you, that guy's a bomber, that guy's an assassin, that guy's a spy, and like they're bad dudes that are working for the good guys. And that's all you really need to know about them. And I think for most of the main characters, you kind of get enough bond. Like, I don't need to know. I like the fact that we get to talk about... Was he a Jedi? Was he not a Jedi? Is he a soldier for the Jedi? What is his story? And we can extrapolate. That's what's great about Star Wars. Yes, they eventually came out with books that explained a lot of this, but some of it we created as a fandom.
We were inspired. We were inspired, and we had so many questions that everything that we needed was in the movie, but we wanted so much more. And that desire created an empire, pardon the pun, that means that Lucas's great-great-grandkids are never going to go to college.
Right. But the argument that I always come up with is Boba Fett. If you solely watch Boba Fett from the movies, he's not all that. Like, everybody's, he's the greatest. He gets shot, falls into a Sarlacc pit, and you know what I mean? So everything that's great about that character comes from the ancillary stuff. And my point is
I would say it doesn't even come from
that stuff, then...
I think it comes from the movie. I mean, you're told it's true, and then he dies, and the thing he kind of... But, like, when I was a kid, not being able to read, Boba Fett was still the most baddest guy in the Star Wars movies as a child, because he looks cool.
Right. His toy was amazing, right?
His action figure was cool. And yes, like, that's still auxiliary content, technically. But from my perspective, and from most moviegoers' perspective, that's fine, that you just are told that this guy's a badass. And I wish he was more badass. I'll give you that. But he figures out, he's the only one that figures out how to get Han Solo. Of the five other guys,
right.
he does outsmart
Han
Solo.
Did he shoot the flamethrower on screen? He shot that on screen, didn't he?
Well, on the third one?
Yeah.
No,
that was the string. He rocketed and stringed. I don't think he...
Yeah, he in Attack of the Clones, Django used
it. Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
So we're running low on time. So why don't we get our final thoughts on what you guys think about the Star Wars movie and where we're going to go from here? So Hannibal, what are your say final encapsulating thoughts?
As I said, I'm very encouraged about anthology films. I'm looking in corners of the Star Wars universe where we've had questions, where we want to expand things, where we want more than what we got, what we needed. Hint, hint. So in that, I'm very excited. Given what I saw in Episode 7, I'm still very concerned about the saga. I'm very concerned about the failure of the Skywalker line and the damage, essentially, that they've done to an entire galaxy and billions of sentients. I got a big problem with that. You know, in certain ways, looking at it, I'm wondering if Palpatine was right, that the Jedi really had to die, you know.
It's
an argument.
That's what the story should have been.
Yeah.
And in the prequels, it should have been about the Jedi become a corrupt, not corrupt necessarily, but like... kind of like a religious extremist.
But I saw that. I mean, they were bloated. They're like, I'm a Jedi. I know what I'm doing. I'm like, well, you don't know nothing about nothing. You don't even know that you've been clouded by the dark side, you asshat.
But on his side, his side is that we were kind of were told that and didn't get to see it.
I mean, no.
But that to me is the danger of when you're a kid and you hear about the Clone Wars and you imagine that in your brain. Yes. And then you find out it literally was these clones that were just expendable, you know, this cannon fodder stuff. And you're like, the way that you see it sometimes, you don't need to be told everything. You don't need to be shown everything. Like, honestly, I don't... If I never saw Rogue One, if I'd never seen it at all, it still doesn't diminish the fact that someone stole the plans and got them to Princess Leia, and we got this amazing Star Wars film. So, like, I guess I feel that they're going to show us everything we were mentioning during the break. We're going to get the Kessel Run in the fucking Han Solo movie.
Yep.
And then it's not going to be as cool as what you thought it was when you heard him say it as a throwaway line in that movie.
Well, honestly, after when I was growing up, I thought that was a cool line. But after I grew up a little, I was like, a parsec's not a matter of time. Right. It's a matter of space.
And if you look at
Obi-Wan, he's like, shut up. All of you are idiots. I just need to get this done.
Nevertheless, we're going to get that in the movie. We're going to get him losing the Millennium.
He's going to get the Millennium Falcon.
I mean, it's all going to be there. We know all of that already. And when they show it to you, I think it diminishes the power of your imagination to figure it out for yourself. When I saw what the actual Jedi were, I was like, fuck, these guys are pussies.
Fortunately, you're not trying to fuel a multi-billion-dollar franchise.
I know.
You know, people got jobs. People got to make money. And to be honest, if they thought that I wasn't going to be in the theater on every opening day, as I've been on every film since The Empire, at least, then they'd be like, they'd worry. But they know I'm going to be there. Right. And they know that giving me this is going to get me there. So from what you're talking about, my thoughts moving forward, I think that my kid is going to, like my 6-year-old right now, she's trying to study style 2, lightsaber style. Because we're going through the different lightsaber styles.
And what is style 2?
I got them all written.
It's the fencing. It's what Dooku does.
Yeah, okay. The fencing. Okay, so fencing. I'm trying to make her a smaller target with footwork and so on and so forth.
Sure.
And she's like, but why can't I just turn and swing? I'm like, nah, you're not ready for that style yet. You're not. I think that there are generations of people who are passing this on to other generations of people who will never care about the literary criticisms that Vito is trying to bring up, who will only care about what they feel and what they're able to share and this feeling that they're able to have as a community. There's a reason why Jedi is a religion in
some places. Yeah,
Australia.
Well, but to be fair, these kids. But to be fair, these kids also love Jar Jar. So, you know, who knows?
Well, that's fine. I loved Ewoks when I was 5 years old. Exactly. And I realize that they're cheesy now.
The one thing, and this is one thing I hate about the geek community a lot of times, we want to police what people like. That's not cool. Like what you like. Be passionate about what you're passionate about. I ain't asking this. I'm in the middle of my point. Thank you.
Okay.
But if people want to like something that you may think is weak, whatever. Because in my mind, especially as a content creator, that brings more people to conventions. That makes more people I can potentially have as customers for my comics. Read Project Wildfire on operative.net. And in that way, you can, build up. You can build up more. I don't need to tear anybody down to enjoy what I enjoy. What Charlie Kaufman's character say in that adaptation? My love is pure. I don't care what she said. What happens outside of me doesn't matter. My love in and of itself is pure. And that is Star Wars to me.
I completely agree. My biggest problem in life, and that's not true, but a problem I have is I love a lot of things. I am a very broad nerd. I love everything from Doctor Who to Star Wars to Magic to Avatar. But The Last Airbender, not the James Cameron movie. Oh, sorry, God, I need to establish that. and it's so hard when you like some. It's much harder to like something, especially in LA, at least, to like something than to not like it. I know many people that are like, oh, I hate this, and they hate this, and it's really easy to do that. And like when you're like, oh, but I like that thing that you hate, it's much harder to kind of be in that position. Mm-hmm. And I like, it's something the nerd community does a lot. It's, you know, if people want to do a thing, let them do it. That's the point of being a nerd. Why absolutely. Would, like, if you like Star Trek and I don't like Star Trek, fine, but just you, I'm happy you like that thing. Because it's better that you're really into something than not. It's something that I often, like, I'm generally joking anti-sports, but in reality, I'm like, oh, I'm glad you like that thing. I just wish I wasn't forced
to. Okay, I have to point out, I'm not geek-shaming any
of these. Oh, no, I'm not blaming you at all.
No, because I often get lumped into that where people are like, you're shitting on what I love. I love Star Wars. I love these movies. I saw the first movie in the theater like 35 times. I love the genre and stuff. I'm just, I like looking at the storytelling stuff and going, well, why would they do this and why would they do that? And, you know, but the thing is, there's a converse to that, too, because there are people who will come at me. I get a lot of emails from people who, you know, think that I'm an asshole and go, well, you're wrong. And I'm not saying that what you love is wrong. I'm saying that I didn't like it. It's a fucking opinion. You know what I mean?
Well, and I think there's a reverse. I think from a content creator's perspective. There are plenty of people who
love Pokemon, and I don't fucking understand that at all. But great. I'm glad that you love it. But I have the right to criticize it just as much as you have the right to defend it. And neither of us are right and neither of us are wrong. It's just an opinion in the end. This is just pop culture, people. In the end, it's not, you know, it's...
Oh, absolutely.
You know what I mean? Well, I will nitpick. I got death threats when I went on Collider Heroes and said that I didn't like Ant-Man as much as the other... I literally got people sending me death threats saying they were going to kill me if they ever saw me in the streets of L.A. So, like,
that's a whole other problem with the internet.
But my point is, I don't want to come off like I'm being a hater with this stuff. I love this stuff, which is why I'm talking
about it. Well, yeah, no, clearly everybody here loves Star Wars. That's why you guys all came on. You guys, you know.
Well, and I, like, sorry.
No, go for it.
I love nitpicking stuff. Mm. There's a reason I like talking on podcasts and being a content creator and discussing movies with people. The reason I love movies is... It's because I love walking out of the movie and be like, this is what I like, this is what I didn't like, these are the flaws. And I will talk the flaws of Empire for days. I will talk about the problems. I love live tweeting Star Wars movies because I like
your Force Awakens.
I pick everything out of it and I'm like, oh, Return of the Jedi has the worst dialogue scene of any Star Wars period. And I will fight. But the scene with Luke and Leia and Han Solo on that stupid Ewok bridge is the worst writing of any movie period. I love Jedi. So like you can say you can pick something's flaws and still love it, I guess is my point. Right. And in fact, I would say if you can recognize the flaws of something and still love it, that's a stronger love than not being blinded by love.
I can see that because, I mean, what I do is, I don't say this Force Awakens is a bad film. I say it's a bad Star Wars film. I'm very specific about it. I stay in genre. I'm not going to try to compare it to, you know, Citizen Kane. I'm going to stick with what it is. And I'm like, in this specific milieu, it fails at these specific points that you should accomplish in a Star Wars film. I'm not going to step outside of that.
We're really coming close to the wire. So I guess if you want to have any last thoughts, and then Vito.
No, go ahead.
Yeah.
So I love this movie. As I said, I kind of gave my review in the beginning. First half is weak. Second half is so strong it makes up for any weakness of the first half. kind of to your point a little bit on The Force Awakens. It's interesting that your comment on it is that it fails at a Star Wars movie, where I feel like everyone else's complaint of that movie, which I disagree with, is that it hits too many of those Star Wars movie points. Its originality is its flaw, or its lack of originality is its flaw.
I think that's saying the same thing.
Okay, and then you establish. So I actually kind of disagree with that, and it's purely based on the fact that Star Wars is in itself derivative.
I mean, if you go with the Star Wars ring theory idea that, you know, it's written is specifically a way to go in and out of the ring theory, this fails trying to double down on some of those things.
But, so, love this movie. That was great. I think that I'm looking for anthology films. I'm looking for the new films. I will just eat all of this content forever.
Of course. despite my nitpickiness, I will see all of the movies. I love the Star Wars universe. I would like to see the Guillermo del Toro proposal of The Godfather with Jabba the Hutt, his rise through Tatooine. I think that'd be an amazing movie. And I do look forward to the Boba Fett movie. Mm-hmm. I think they've got a lot of potential there
I think they're smushing it in with the Han Solo movie.
Okay.
That's the rumor. Josh Trank ditched it.
I'm not so enthusiastic by that one, but it's just because, I have a an image of what the Kessler run is going to be like. I don't want to see it in the movie and be like, that was
it's black holes.
Well, yeah, it could be going through a meteor belt or whatever like that. You know, like trying to get from point A to point B, the shortest route. But
there's a great race in the Han Solo comic where he has to do the space race. It's awesome.
Yeah. So you know, I mean, absolutely, there are things that we can find out. Like you know, why does Dengar have all those bandages, right? Oh. Like, you know, I want to see a Dengar.
He just got out of surgery.
It's hot.
I thought he was like Tim Allen.
It's like, I think, like, you know, there's this whole, like, bounty hunter called Dengar the Beautiful. And then throughout the course of successive missions,
Mickey Rourke just gets Dengar.
You know? Yeah, and then at the end, he's just, like, all bandaged up. Like, oh, guys.
You should have seen what I had to go through.
On movies, I really want to see Obi-Wan Kenobi, The Unforgiven. Meets Unforgiven, the movie. I just want, like, in the desert.
Oof.
Yeah.
Seems that would be so sweet.
They did some awesome. Of that in the comic.
Yeah.
All right, so really quickly, we'll start with you, Hannibal. Tell us who you are, where we can find your stuff.
I'm Hannibal Tabu. You can find me at Comic Book Resources every Thursday with the Buy Power Review column. You can find me on operative.net with weekly web comics. Right now it's Project Wildfire. And my website is HannibalTabu.com. It's also Hannibal Tabu on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Tumblr.
Cool.
I am the host of the Masters of Modern podcast. It's about magic, so if you don't like magic, I don't know if that's the best place to start at. It's at the MMCast on Twitter. Follow me at Kess Wiley on Twitter. You can follow my YouTube channel, which is it's topdecking.tv, it's youtube.com/topdeckingtv. And then also, more importantly, check out the website, kess.co. It's my toy company. It's in the rough draft, but we're launching games and toys this year, so we'll come with all these cool items to play with.
Cool.
Awesome. You can find me at Vito Lapicola on Twitter, although I never tweet, and Vito Lapicola on Facebook. And I'm working on a couple of projects, which I don't want to announce because they are not solid. So I don't
Sweet. All right.
I'm one with the Force, and the Force is with me.
That's right.
Oh, yeah. This was Comics on Comics Season 8. You can find us on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. And just really quickly, I wanted to say that this is the end of Season 8, which would be the end of our 10-year anniversary of doing podcasting.
Woo! Nice.
We started in April of 2006. I was really surprised that we've now hit this milestone. So Season 9 should be coming up in, you know, probably around WonderCon or maybe March, February, March, thereabouts. And hopefully we'll have cool things to announce and stuff like that. So everybody who's been watching for 10 years, you know, thank you so much for following us and being a part of the discussion. And thank you so much. We will see you next year. And this has been Comics on Comics, the show where the greatest comic minds meet the greatest minds in comics.
Great.
What's your Twitter?